Yes, I was just jamming. Yeah. Everybody just caught me jamming. Hello, everyone. Hello out there in Facebook land. Hello out there in YouTube land. It is Thursday. It is 6 p.m. So you know it is time for another episode of That's My Story. This week we are on episode number 17. And as usual, we invite you guys to come on in, share the link with your friends, pull up a seat, get you something to drink, get you a snack. And we have a great chat in store for you all this evening. I go by the name of Jerry Midas Hardison. Joining me on the panel, as every week, once again, my illustrious co-hosts, starting with the lovely lady here, representing the iCats and the Honeycomb, singer-entertainer, Miss Shelly Clark White. She's also the wife of Mr. Verdeen White, the bass player of Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Yeah.
Also joining me, as usual, is vocalist, musician, producer, arranger, representing the Chairmen of the Board out of Detroit, Mr. Ken Knox.
What's up?
Excited.
Hey, Shelly, how you doing?
What's going on?
Awesome. There's a buzz. I'm sorry?
You good?
Yeah.
Man, I can't complain. There's a buzz in the air today.
Uh-oh.
Oh, yeah.
Uh-oh.
And normally, I was going to show you guys, normally, you know, we accustomed to, you guys have been seeing us the last few weeks drink out of this this particular wine glass.
Yeah.
And this week, we had to switch it up a little bit.
Oh, yeah.
For our special guest, Earth, Wind, and Earth, Wind, and Fire tonight. So before we get started, hold on.
Okay. Yeah, we got
a little communion. How you guys been doing this week? What you guys been up to?
Everything's good on this end. What about you?
Oh, man. Well, getting my son Isaiah ready for virtual online schooling. So staying on top of staying on.
Yes.
But, you know, we got our feet wet initially in March when, you know, COVID came and shut the school system down. So just staying on top of those emails, making sure that, you know, we're on task as we progress to start school on Monday from home.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, you know what I've been doing.
At the drive-through.
I've been in drive-throughs. you know, I don't feel comfortable going in, which you can't anyway.
Okay.
You know, I'm much better. I mean, the food is not that great, but hey, I needed some southern home cooking.
You gotta eat, you know?
Yeah, you gotta eat. Gotta eat.
What's that?
Go ahead.
No, I was just gonna say, I don't know if it was Benjamin Franklin, but he had a saying that said, live to eat. Eat to live, not live to eat. So yeah, but eating is definitely necessary.
Yeah.
All right. We're giving everyone a moment to get signed in. While we do that, we want to remind you all to please like and subscribe to our YouTube channel as well as our Facebook page.
Hey.
We'll give a few shout outs. We've got Elliot Tanner.
Uli. Hey, Uli from Vienna.
Thank you.
My girl.
Hello.
And my girl, Marisa.
Marisa.
Marisa Kelly on there.
All right.
Yeah. All right, Hattie.
Hattie's
regular.
Hey, yeah. You know what? Hattie's my schoolmate.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, Hattie's my schoolmate from Detroit.
Uh-oh.
Good evening, Linda Lane. Good evening, Hattie. Good evening, Mom.
Francis.
Hey, Mom.
Love you, Mom. I think Francis. I saw my Aunt Florence is on. And I got to give a shout out, a happy birthday shout out to my Aunt Marilyn, a.k.a. Judy. Today is her actual birthday, my mom's baby sister.
Oh, wow. Happy birthday.
Yes, indeed. All right, guys.
One more. Hey, from the UK. Yeah.
I see you.
You see her?
Okay.
I see Brooke. Yeah. Uh-oh, I see Rhonda. Hey, Rhonda.
Yeah, we thank you guys. So, Brooke is on. She's also a DJ over in the UK. Brooke,
thank you
for joining us. We thank you all. You know, I can't say it enough from week to week because without you guys, there would be no platform where we could come on and talk to some of your favorite musicians, artists, engineers, producers, and you know, and it's such a treat that they give us a behind the scenes look into their journey through as they have navigated their particular industry over these particular years. So we thank you guys at home so much. Yeah. All right.
I see you, Jamarian. I see you.
Yeah.
Representing Shelly from Georgia. Okay.
That's right. There you go.
We got you.
All right. Well, I'm not going to prolong the time any further. I guess if you're ready to proceed, we can do that. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I know you guys are waiting. So without any further ado, allow me to welcome and introduce a singer, a songwriter, musician, producer, five-time American Award winner, seven-time Grammy Award winner, Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award winner. He has also received a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. He's been inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, also a recipient of the Kennedy Center Honors, giving you such hits like Let's Groove Tonight, September, Reasons, After the Love Has Gone, also referred to as the principal of Earth, Wind, and Fire. Make some noise at home as we make some noise here on the screen for Mr. Ralph Johnson.
Johnson!
There you go.
Hey there.
Good afternoon, good evening, and in some places, good morning.
You know? Hey, how's it going?
How you doing, sir? It is going. I've been looking forward to doing this, and we're going to have a lot of fun.
Yes, indeed.
Oh, we're excited. I think our viewers are very, very excited as well. So it's a pleasure to have you on.
Thank you. We always
like to ask our guests before we get into the actual chat and discussion, being that we are all in the entertainment industry, and you know, COVID came about back in March, and we've been, you know, kind of stuck at home during this pandemic. I always like to ask our guests, what have they been doing to utilize their time? Since you're not on the road and everything.
That's a very excellent question. And I decided since I have so much time at home that I would start teaching drums online. Hey. So I put a quick little blip on Facebook and gathered up a few students. And so every week throughout the week, I'm teaching by way of Zoom, drum students, you know? And so I get a lot of, pleasure out of teaching. You know, I really enjoy doing it. And so it's just one of those special things, you know,
Absolutely.
Teaching and doing some cooking too.
Yeah. Oh, okay. And you got to give the people at home a few of those dishes that you like to chef up.
Spaghetti.
I do a pretty decent lasagna.
You know,
when I first traveled to Europe, I had something called peppered steak. And I said, you know what? I'm going to do a little peppered steak, you know, with this.
A little spice is good.
Yeah. You know, well, I have a problem with spice. I like spice.
Me too. So sometimes you pay for it.
I do. Yeah.
Yeah, you do.
I do. Yes, it can happen. But I enjoy cooking. You know, it's something, you know, let me tell you the story.
Go ahead.
When I was living at home, my mother would fix a dish, and I said, "Mom, how do you fix that?" And so my whole thing was, I never wanted to be with a woman who would get mad at me and say, "Okay, well then I won't cook."
Oh yeah. Good point.
I tell you what, why don't you have a seat over there? I'll cook, and you can enjoy it. Okay.
Absolutely.
So from there, I just kept going, and usually on Saturday mornings, I'm on the Food Network watching cooking shows for the first few hours of the day.
That's awesome.
A lot of musicians do that.
There's some musicians that can cook.
Yes, indeed.
I was just telling you guys in the virtual green room, I did some ribs yesterday, but I'm not going to get all into that.
I bet they're gone.
They are.
Half for anybody.
Half at first and the second half later. So, Ralph, you were born July 4th on Independence Day.
July 4th, 1951. Just celebrated my 69th birthday.
Awesome. Congrats.
Oh, look at that. Yeah.
Congrats. Wow.
That's me and Dad. Dad and I. But I have an older brother, 8 years older than me, born on the same day.
How old were you when you got into drums? Or how did it come about?
I took my first drum lesson at 8 years old.
Wow, 8 years old. Yeah. And did you
fell in love with it and just kept going and going. I I looked up. Oh my God, that's a Christmas shot. Yeah. And I looked up one Christmas, and there was a snare drum under the Christmas tree. And that started it, you know, and I started taking lessons, and I just fell in love with it. And, you know, I just kept going and going and going, and, you know, became a love affair, you know. Now,
Who was that snare drum from under the Christmas tree?
It's from Santa Claus, man. You know what's up. Come on. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Well, that's going. Boy, look, y'all, somebody's been doing some real digging, I'm telling you.
But listen, Ralph, I'm sure your parents encouraged you early on.
You know what? You raise a very good point, because I never heard any discouraging words from my parents. I would come home from school and jump on my drums, and I never, ever remember my father or my mother saying, okay, Ralph, you know, that's enough now. It's time to, you know, no, I never got that. I can practice anytime I want it for as long as I want.
Yeah, so it seems like your parents almost had the ability to see into the future.
Yeah, they definitely picked up on something. And I have to say, one of my proudest moments, back in the 70s, we did a 5-night run at the Forum. This had to be around 78, 79, I think, maybe even 77. Okay. And, you know, see, I'm from Inglewood. So I watched, when we first moved to Inglewood in 66, I watched the Forum being built.
Really?
Yeah. I saw it being built. And so one of my proudest moments was to be able to invite them to the show after watching the Forum being built and let them see, you know, what I had come into by way of Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Wow.
Awesome. You know? Awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So before Earth, Wind, and Fire, of course, there was school, right? High school.
Oh, yeah. I went
Oh, my God. Look at that.
Oh, my God. So Y'all are really pulling them out here. I went to Morningside High School, Mount Vernon Junior High School. Matter of fact, I got a great story, and it's regarding Shelly.
Okay.
When I was at Mount Vernon Junior High School, Shelly went to L.A. High School. Their dance band came over. She was singing with the band, and she sang When Sunny Gets Blue.
Wow. That's
That's awesome. Great.
We crossed and that was long before Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Wow.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
So that's awesome.
I remember that. That was a moment. I was like, wow, okay.
Amazing.
I wanted to go to LA High School, but we moved. We moved south, further south out to 90th and 8th Avenue. And so that put me in the Inglewood School District, and I wound up going to Morningside. And I came out of there in 1969.
What were your musical influences when you were in school?
Well, I mean, I was listening. We had a lot of, you know, one thing about growing up in LA, we had a lot of great radio stations for all genres. I mean, if you were in the country and western, there was a country and western station on AM somewhere. But we had great AM stations, K-Day, K-D-A-Y, K-G-F-J. And then you had the pop stations, K-H-J, K-R-L-A, K-F-W-B. Dale, I know I'm ringing some bells with these call letters.
Yeah.
I just remember all that. I listened to a lot of Motown. I love Motown music.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. And I was always attracted to the bass.
Okay.
Because, as you know, the bass player was James Jamerson.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And nobody could do to a song what he could do with the bass, you know. So I always gravitated to the bass. So, but finishing the answer, all R&B stuff, all R&B stuff. And then at 14, I got turned on to jazz. And and that's because my older brother came home from the Air Force in 65 and came home with this stack of albums. It was all jazz, it was vinyl. And I started listening to these records. I said, man, really?
Wow.
Okay. Come to discover, we had a 24-hour jazz station in L.A., KBCA 105.1. And I started listening to these jocks on there who all were different. They all had different personalities, you know. And I would just tune into that. And I go, man, one day I want to do that. I finally did that.
Nice.
I finally did that. you know. So, but anyway, yeah, that's so coming up to answer your question, all yeah. types of music. All
well, that's great. So yeah. at the high school, I think you guys had a band called the Teen Turbans.
Well, the when I was band? In junior high, actually. Oh my God. Yeah, and you know what? With this band right here that you see,
yeah.
The local pop station, KHJ93, was throwing a battle of the bands.
Okay.
And we entered and we took first place. We were the only black group in it. And I can tell you that was the night of May the 10th, 1966.
Wow. You'll never forget it.
Never forget it, man. I mean, all the guys got brand new instruments, Selmer horns, Fender amplifiers and guitars, you know, so it was quite a win for us. You know, but that group was called
Al McKay in there?
No, that wasn't Al McKay.
That wasn't
because
Al.
Because it used to be Al McKay and the Turbans. The night I walked into their rehearsal with my bass player and my guitar player, Al was walking out with his bass player and guitar, his bass player and drummer.
Okay.
So we just moved right into the slot, set up, and we just kept going.
Wow.
Okay.
So it was a very interesting thing. And so, yeah, it was. So our group was called the Teen Turbans.
Yeah. Okay. So you guys, you recorded something. I think it's called "We Need to Be Loved."
Was that?
You did a recording or a video called "We Need to Be Loved."
You know, that doesn't ring a bell. We need to be loved. Was that the Teen Turbans or was that
Teen Turbans? Yeah.
Okay. All right. Because we did. There was one little record deal that came through, and then it went away, and then you know, so I don't. Yeah, I'd have to be reminded of that music.
You can be reminded right now because we have a
clip.
I think this is on Warner Brothers.
Yeah. It might. I think you may be right. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Check it out. Empty heartache and
Who produced that?
Can you know who produced that? I'm just curious.
Not right.
I know it was a subsidiary of Warner's, like a smaller label.
Yeah.
With a D. I can't remember, but
okay. Wow.
But
man.
I think there were two sisters in that group, right? And then the
Georgetta and Zeddy. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. And Iris Flowers was the other vocalist.
Iris was the daughter to the manager.
The manager.
The father.
Yeah, right. And his son, Luke Flowers, was also in the band too.
Wow.
Look at y'all coming up with it.
We're taking you all the way back.
Celebrate.
That's my story. That's your story.
Well, yeah. Yeah. Right. Yeah, apparently it is.
Yeah. All right.
This is your life. Okay, so at some point early on, in the early years, tell us how this happened. You were on the TV show Julia and Diane Carroll, and that was a groundbreaking show. She was the first black woman who did a series in a non-stereotypical role. So that was great. Who called you for that show?
I remember that. The booking agency, which I think was William Morris.
Okay.
Somebody from the agency came down and they needed a drummer. Mm. And so there was another drummer there by the name of Manuel Kellogg that auditioned. Manuel was playing with a group at the same club, Mavericks Flat. He was playing with a group called the Rhythm Rebellion, which was a hell of a group. Mm. There was another drummer with a group called the Seven Souls. That was Fred Murphy. And I was with a group called the Master's Children. And so they looked at all of us, but I got the gig. The name of that episode was "You Can't Beat Drunk." Pops. It was directed by a gentleman by the name of Ezra Stone.
Oh wow, okay, that sounds familiar.
Ezra Stone. Yeah, and so I remember that man. I just
I think we might have a clip from Julia. Let's see.
Nice.
Wow.
Nice. That was
wow.
Nice.
That's going back. That is, boy, notice how clean shaven I was too, you know.
Yeah.
But yeah, and the guitar player was Ronnie Van, who was with us in The Master's Children.
Okay. You know, that was my next question. being in The Master's Children, who made up, that was your next group, right? Who made up that group? And,
well, that at that time, the hottest club in LA was the place called Maverick Flat. It was on Crenshaw Boulevard.
Hi, you know it.
4225 Crenshaw Boulevard. And John Daniels, who owned the club, had a way of pulling people out the neighborhood and putting these groups together.
Mm.
And then he would just send them out. He'd send them overseas and they would just hang out, you know. But I was drafted into the Master's Children. They asked me if I wanted to play drums. I was playing with another group called the New Perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, hey, man, you want to come play drums with us? I said, yeah, sure. Because I'd seen the performer. I was like, they're a great group. The Master's Children were a cross between Sly and the Family Stone and the Fifth Dimension.
Wow.
Nice. You know? Yeah. Nice. And we were a show group, you know, and we would give you a heck of a show. And the organ player, Robert Sam, would go on to play organ with Graham Central Station, Butch. You know,
okay.
So yeah, that's, and that's actually how Maurice and Verdine saw me or discovered me. It was at that club, you know, Maverick's Flat, playing with the Master's Children. And well, so I was with them for a couple of years.
Well, I know me and my BFF, you know, your tennis buddy, D. We used to, that was our haunt. Maverick's Flat, everybody went every weekend.
Everybody played there too. All the artists played there.
Yeah.
So and, how did they approach you after they saw you? What happened?
They said, hey man, we got this group, we're the Master's Children, and we just, you know, we're looking for a drummer. They weren't happy with their drummer. He was a bit of a clown. So they were looking for somebody who could really play. And they asked me if I wanted to come into the group. I said, yeah, sure. Because I already knew they had a rep at the club. Mm-hmm. So I said, yeah, let's do it. You know, and so it was headed up by Douglas Gibbs, who I would later write some songs with.
Right.
And And so, yeah, I joined up with them. And we had great. We went to Japan. I went to Japan with the Master's Children 10 years before I went with Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Wow.
Earth, Wind, and Fire didn't hit Japan until 79. I was there in 69, straight out of high school.
Wow.
And then went back the next summer in 1970.
Okay.
You know, 2 years in a row. Well, we were playing at a club in Tokyo in the Akasaka district, which was called the Mugen. It was a very hot club at that time, you know. And we spent 2.5 months each time. You know, it was
Verdine said that Earth, Wind, and Fire played Maverick's Flat, but they got booed off the stage. So it's good you weren't with them then.
I don't think you were with them then. I didn't experience that. But there was, there was a similar experience after I joined Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Right.
Okay, we did a gig up in the Bay Area. And you'll love this. So we go on stage and do our, before us, there was an act called the Sisters Love, which I think, I want to say Sly Stone was producing. I may be wrong.
Okay.
But so we're doing our set and they were like, oh, bring back the Sisters Love. Bring back. We're like, damn, okay. So so our set is finished and we're in the bathroom getting dressed. Well, in walks this guy carrying on his side, a hi-hat stand, a total hi-hat, cymbals and all.
Right.
And he goes in the stall, does what he has to do, comes back out with the hi-hat and leaves. Matter of fact, so we're getting dressed to go on. So I we hit the stage. I looked over my drum set and my hi-hat was gone.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
This cat had ripped off my, I couldn't believe it. I said, wow, welcome to the business. Yeah. You know,
well,
so yeah, but that was an incident. Yep. And then much later, after we got our stuff together, we would go to D.C. and play at the D.C. Armory. And we were coming on before the Funkadelics. Thank you. And at that time, the Funkadelics owned D.C. Man, look, they... Well, see, we go on and do our set, you know, Love, Peace, and Granola. And we come off, and man, their band is up on stage, and they struck up this groove, and the three of us will never forget it, because the groove is like, and all the heads in the audience started bobbing up and down in the smoke. Yeah. They came out the bathroom with a trail of smoke, and man, they wiped us out. And so Marie says, okay, that'll never happen again. And we went back to LA and rehearsed and rehearsed and rehearsed until we finally gelled. And the next time we met up with the Funkadelics, it was a different thing.
Wow.
And, you know, like a little friendly competition. What comes around goes around.
So in your early years with Earth, Wind, and Fire, you guys worked with a gentleman named Bob Dixon.
Nail in the head.
Nail in the head. Because he was the first one to come to us talking about special effects.
Yeah.
And so the idea he had was to spin the drum set while I was playing.
That's what I was going to ask you. So he came up with that.
That was him.
All right.
And of course, I mean, and this was before Freddie White joined the band as the other drummer. So I said, yeah, well, let's do it. How do we go about doing it? So we figured it all out. And that became the effect at the end of the show. We would usually, at that time, we were closing the show with the tune called Mighty Mighty.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when they would bring me up and they would spin the drum set and I would just keep playing, you know, and that was the beginning of special effects for us.
Uh-huh.
Later on, it would be Doug Henning and David Copperfield, and the stuff would become more sophisticated.
Well, guess what, Ralph? We have a video of the spinning drum set.
What? Wow. Wow. Yeah, let me tell you, that's very rare footage.
What? That's some very rare footage.
Were you strapped in?
Yeah, I was strapped in. Everything was wired down.
Yeah.
And the hardest part really was playing the bass drum. The gravity was fighting.
Oh, yeah, for the kick drum, right?
Keep that foot consistent. But I enjoyed it, and it was so funny. After that, the gentleman that was flying us around in our four-engine turboprop, he said, you know what? I saw you go inverted, playing upside down. He says, you'd make a good pilot. And he taught me how to fly. His name was Duke Morton.
Duke. Awesome.
Yeah, oh, Duke. Wow. Yep. Duke Morton taught me how to fly.
Wow.
I'm still a student pilot because I haven't finished and gotten my license. But he would say to me, because we come off a tour, we would come off a tour and I'd go back to my flight lessons. And he would say, man, you have amazing retention. He says, you jump back in the airplane like you never left it. And I'm like, well, whatever that is, let's get up in the air and do something, you know.
Nice.
But I enjoy it. But I'm really into aviation. I really enjoy military aircraft.
Mm-hmm.
For the past 3 years, around late September, I go down to Miramar Air Station in San Diego and I go see the Blue Angels.
Okay.
Yeah.
You got many, many passions.
There's a lot of stuff I like to do. And, you know, one thing about me, if I'm interested in something, I will go after it and I will get it up to a certain level, you know, in terms of achievement, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just the way I've always been. Because the idea of starting something and not finishing is a mind. Well,
look at that.
There you go.
Wow. Well, okay. Well, okay. Since we're gonna go there, you know, when we had our turboprop, and we would leave a city at night to fly to the next city. Duke, the pilot, so I always sat up front with Maurice. I would sit across the aisle from Maurice. And after we got up to our, what we call cruise altitude, Duke would open the door to the cabin and he'd look back and he'd say, and then we'd close the door and I'd start flying the plane.
Get out of here.
No, he would let me fly the plane. No one ever knew it.
Wow.
Matter of fact, this wasn't it. This story right here wasn't told until Maurice's memorial.
Oh, yeah.
People were like, "What? You were flying?" I said, "Yeah." He would let me fly the plane. Then I would just, awesome. After a few minutes, he said, "Okay, I'll take over," and I'd go back to my seat. And you know,
we ran into Duke a couple of years ago. He's still around. He looks great. He looks the same.
Where did, was he here in L.A.?
Yeah, we were at a restaurant called Typhoon. In West LA at the airport.
Santa Monica Airport.
Yeah, Santa Monica.
Yeah. Right. Great. Well, that's where I started taking my flight lessons, Santa Monica.
Okay. Okay.
You know. So yeah, that was a great experience. That was a great experience. I love being up in the air. I tell people, you know, if I wasn't in the music business, I would either be a super duper culinary star, I'd be a very expert chef, or I'd be in the military. And I'd probably be in the Air Force just so I could be around the aircraft.
Right.
So there you have it.
Yeah. Hey, listen, Jack of many trades. Now you were also on a show called Soul, right? And you were new in the band at that time, and they chose to highlight you or spotlight you, I should say.
Well, so was that? I think that was the thing we did. That's when Jessica was in the group singing, That was probably our first ever TV show was done in New York. And you can still find footage of that on YouTube. You know.
Oh, really? Because I think we got some.
Okay, let's see what we got.
What?
You nice. Had it locked. Yeah, nice. I was locked in. Funky.
Nice.
Well, thank you. Thank
nice.
You.
Yeah.
No, nice. I remember. I definitely remember doing that show. No doubt about it.
Yep.
You know.
They left you up there, huh?
Yeah, they left you. Yeah. So we kind of planned it out beforehand. So Marie said, "Hey, look, here's what we're gonna do." You know. So, you know, it was very spontaneous, and you know, and right there was kind of the beginning of the theatrics that we would get into later on as a group. You know, it started really kind of right there.
Right.
Yeah. Because Maurice didn't want a band that was just going to stand in one place on the stage and just play. You know, he wanted some motion, you know, which is why much later on we went and got George Faison, who became our choreographer. And George was hot already because he had choreographed The Wiz on Broadway.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. You know, so Maurice called him out. He began to work with us, and that's how we began body movement and learned how to move. And it's something we still carry over today. It's just, now it's just natural.
Natural, you know, absolutely. Natural. It looks very natural.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. Very kind. Yeah. Your check's in the mail.
I'm gonna be looking for
it. Yours is too, Shelly. We got an earlier check for you. Yeah.
Yeah.
So look, And I guess your writing skills were starting to come into play. You wrote a song in 1980 called Let Me Talk.
Yeah, I was one of the writers on Let Me Talk, and that started my, you know, my writing affair with Earth, Wind, and actually I started gravitating toward the interludes too much later. But then after Let Me Talk, on the Heritage CD, we had a tune called Welcome, you know, and that Maurice and I collaborated on the lyrics on that too, you know.
But on Let Me Talk, I think you guys recorded in the West Indies.
That was recorded. Yes, yes.
Well, how did that come about?
It was a place called Montserrat. It was an island called Montserrat.
Yeah, a lot of people used to recording down there.
Yeah,
artists recorded down there.
I think that studio got destroyed because there was a volcanic eruption that took place on that island. Mm-hmm. If I'm not mistaken. And that studio may have been destroyed.
Wow. Know? So, yeah. But how did the whole thing come about, you know, recording down there in West Indies?
Well, Maurice was very much into just to change things up and to keep us away from distraction. Mm-hmm. He would say, okay, you know, we're going to record such and we're going to go here and record. We're going to over there and record. Mm-hmm. A couple of times we recorded, like That's the Way the World was recorded up at the Caribou Ranch, which was a recording ranch owned by James William Guercio, and James William Guercio was the producer of Chicago, but before that, Blood, Sweat, and Tears.
Mm. Okay. Yeah.
Just giving you give me a little trivia right there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
The audience is loving it. So I think we have a clip of Let Me Talk.
Okay. Let's see that.
Oh, my. Okay.
We got you.
Coming, hold on. Let me see something, guys. I think Taz might have got booted off.
Oh, hold wow. On. I think she did.
Hold on.
Hold on. Let's see what we got.
Yeah.
No problem. Let's see. Give me 1 second here. Okay. See if I can find it.
All right.
Hey, I got nothing but time. We ain't good shit.
we all got
I got it.
Time.
I got it. Here we
you
go.
Got it? Okay.
Now, funky. I gotta tell you,
funky.
I still have those glasses.
Oh, wow.
Oh, really?
I still have, they're up right upstairs right now.
Okay.
And the reason I even went to those glasses is because George Faison came to me and said, Ralph, we need to find a look for you. What can we do? And I thought about it, I said, man, I could meet some really, because I was checking out Elton John and these way out glasses he was wearing. I said,
yeah,
God, give me some really, really cool glass. So there was a place on Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood called the Optique Boutique.
I remember them. I had the star glasses.
Right. Wow. I knew that would ring a bell with Shell.
Yep.
So I went up there and told them what I wanted to do, and they hooked me up with the glasses, and you know, that became my look. So if you look on front of even the Faces LP, I'm wearing those glasses, you know.
Did I see your initials carved in there?
Yeah, my initials were
customized.
Nice.
Yeah,
nice.
They're right upstairs. They're right up there.
Boy.
I had a question though. Right. Was Andrew Woolfolk in the group then?
Absolutely.
Okay. I was looking for him on that clip.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. You know.
Nice.
So
nice.
Ralph, little known information about you. Well, maybe some know, but you have produced some great artists, The Temptations, Howard Hewitt. Yeah, Howard Hewitt, just to name a couple. There's Howard. Just to name a couple. How did you get into producing, and who else did you produce that we couldn't dig up?
Well, so, you know, truth be told, you were one of my artists earlier on.
That's right.
On.
That's right. Okay, okay. Right after the honeycomb.
Yeah. Nice. Howard Hewitt, The Temptations, Syeda Garrett. I have a great Howard Hewitt story, because Howard was part of one of those groups that was at Maverick's Flat.
Mm-hmm.
Or he would later become a part, because he had just hit town. And so I'm on the dance floor with my lady, and the tune that's playing is Love Ballad by LTD.
Oh, yeah.
And so I'm dancing, and I hear this voice over here, and he's just singing along with this. And I was like, damn, somebody's really singing. So I'm with my lady. I'm starting to move around, trying to find where his voice. And it was Howard Hewitt. I said, man, I said, do you record? I said, would you be interested in doing some stuff? He said, yeah. You know, so I take credit for discovering Howard Hewitt.
Yeah, as you should.
Yes. You know? Yeah.
But I love to write and produce, you know.
Okay.
I learned a lot sitting up under Maurice White. Because he was one of the greatest teachers about him and Charles Stepney.
Right.
You know,
Jeez.
Yep.
What about my favorite, Treat Her Like a Lady?
Ha ha.
That's my
I go to visit Al when he was living in the Los Feliz area. He had a beautiful home over there. And he comes to me and he says, hey man, how would you like to help me produce The Temptations for Motown? And I thought it was a joke. You know, I said, man, are you kidding? He says, no, man. The Motown called, they want me to do an album. He said, you want to help me? I said, I'd love to. And we came up with the album Truly For You. Out of that came the hit single Treat Her Like a Lady, which was written by Ollie Woodson.
Yes.
And when you listen to that, know that he did that vocal in just one take.
All the way through.
Start to finish, you know. Mm. And we had Motown loved the record. They loved it. It's one of the best. Still today, Otis will tell you it's one of the best records they've ever done.
Wow.
I take a lot of pride in that. You know, that was a great moment for me. At the same time, right around that same time, Philip Bailey would be working with Phil Collins.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And, which one was that?
And that was the album Chinese Wall. And I had a tune on there that I submitted that made the record. It was called Go, which was very Earth, Wind & Fire sounding. Don Myrick took an incredible alto sax solo. There was a lot in that little period right there. There was energy going on, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well,
awesome. I don't want to ruin this next story. You were minding your own business, and you got word that some hip hop mogul wanted to sample one of your songs. Now, what was that?
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, let me tell the story. So, this is in the summer of 2000. Mm-hmm. I think it was around July. Okay. I get a phone call, and I answer the phone, and this voice says, "Are you Ralph Johnson?" I say, "Yeah. I'm Ralph Johnson." He says, I just want to let you know you've been sampled. I said, oh, cool, man. I've been waiting to get sampled. Everybody else has been sampled. So who sampled me? He said, Jay-Z.
Mm. I heard that record too.
I literally took the phone and went.
Yeah.
I said, the Jay-Z? He said, yeah, the Jay-Z. You've been sampled by. And so when Jay-Z released Blueprint, it was called The Blueprint. That was his first Blueprint CD. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I had a tune on there called Song Cry.
And that was you.
That was myself. But that song started out, the song that he sampled, which was a thing called Sounds Like a Love Song, was written by myself and Douglas Gibbs from The Master's Children.
Yeah, Douglas. Mm.
And Douglas and I did a lot of writing together. And I couldn't believe it, you know. And so that became Song Cry for Jay-Z. And I should say, yeah. Jay-Z been very good to me.
Yeah.
And then most recently, earlier this year, I was sampled by Drake.
Okay.
Yeah, a little piece called When to Say When. And he used the same sample that Jay-Z.
Different way. Yeah. Shout out to Jet.
I've been sampled by a couple of hip hop giants, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not complaining, you know.
Yeah. It's awesome, man. Checks in the mail.
Yeah, we missed
in the mail.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm waiting on mine, man.
Yeah, there you go. You
know. Yeah.
Well, jumping back to EWF for just a minute, you guys have traveled the whole world.
Yes.
And there was a performance, a standout performance in 1980 in Sao Paulo, Brazil. You shocked the pants off of everybody when you started communicating. I guess the language was Portuguese. Is that correct?
It is Portuguese, yes.
And you were talking to the people. You shut it down, okay? Mm. You shut it down. And I think that we have a video of that.
Oh no, right. Get out. Stop it. Wait a minute.
This gentleman started with us on drums. We call him Slick, Mr. Ralph Johnson.
Nice.
I don't even know what you said, but I was laughing.
You oh yeah, laugh.
Did you see the look on the band's face? Phillip,
oh yeah,
they were pretty
shocked.
Yeah.
But you know, I had learned when I heard we were going to Brazil, I had taken out time to study the language a little bit because I somehow have a thing about foreign languages, mm-hmm. and so when we go to a country, if we're called upon to make some kind of statement in the native language, I'm usually the guy that's called upon to make the statement because I just have this thing about foreign languages, but I love Portuguese and that's why I learned it. So, you know, it was just one of those moments and I was able to utilize that skill and here we are back in Los Angeles. I think
we all want to know, what did you say?
I'm paraphrasing, but I said, it's been a very long time since we've been here. And welcome to the show.
Oh,
nice. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, I speak Spanish. I'm glad because we live in LA. So that was a good language to take up in school.
Amen. Yes, you know what's funny? In school, in junior high school and in high school, I did take foreign language. I took French, which when we go to Paris, I start whipping that French out.
Yep.
I love the language, you know.
Yep.
You see, Latin-based languages have a connection. So it could be Spanish, French,
sure.
Italian, Portuguese. Mm-hmm. They're all connected in a certain way. And so once you learn a little bit of one language, mm-hmm. then you can kind of find your way into another,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
So I took French in junior high school and high school and dropped out both times. If you had told me, dig it, if you had told me that I would be traveling the world, I would have really buckled down and got that stuff together. I learned more about foreign languages as an adult than I did in school taking classes, because really you had to take a foreign language. I said, okay, I'll take a language. Right. You know, but had you said, guess what, Ralph, you're going to need this, so you really need to buckle down and get it, you know, so that's what happened with that.
I get it. Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about your love for jazz.
Oh, man. Well, as I, you know, I got turned on to jazz in 1965 when my older brother, who is born on the same day as I, July 4th, he was coming home from the Air Force, and he came home with this incredible collection of jazz albums. And I started listening to this, and I was like, man, this is a whole new thing here. And then I discovered that we had a 24-hour jazz station in Los Angeles. It was KBCA 105.1. And just fell in love with the sound of the station, the jocks, how they would present their shows, and the music itself. You know, and I just started listening and just taking it all in and just kept going, you know, man. It became a study, you know.
Yeah. Now, did I hear you say that you have an older brother that has the same birthday as you as well?
Yeah, July 4th.
Oh, okay.
He's 8 years older than me. He's our USC graduate, a retired LAPD lieutenant. We are as different as night and day.
Okay, well, it's all good. I hear you also have a radio show, if I'm not mistaken, called Epicenter 6.7.
Thank you for the 4 hours you sent me. It's wonderful.
thank you, Shell. You know what? Yeah, I do have a show. It's called Jazz Epicenter 6.7, the finest in jazz from the 60s and 70s. Mm-hmm. And it's all about what I heard at KBCA, Shell, growing up in L.A. You know, I just fell in love with that sound and the music. And I said, you know, one day I'm going to do a show. And so when we went to, I'm going to say it was 2016, when we went to Europe and we were in London, and our good friend Nick Stewart, who always takes care of us when we go over there, I said, Nick, I have an idea, man. I said, I have an idea for a radio show. He says, really? He says, tell me about it. I said, well, it's a jazz show. It's just mainstream jazz from the 60s and 70s, and I think I could do a heck of a show. He says, well, I just happen to know the head of BBC Radio 2. He says, I'll speak with him. And so after we got home after the tour, BBC Radio 2 flew a producer over here, and I did those shows, Shell, that you know I have in your possession.
Right.
We did it over at NPR Studios over on Jefferson Boulevard. And I had a wonderful time selecting the playlist, you know, and giving it's music supported by various anecdotal stories about the musicians and, you know, whatever. Yeah. And it's something that I really enjoy doing. And, you know, I got to figure out something else to do with it. I must monetize it.
Indeed. And in the year 2000, you and Morris Pleasure joined together on a project called Audio Caviar.
Yes, that is correct.
And you guys recorded, down in Copenhagen, Denmark.
Well, it started there. Then we brought it back home and finished it up here with my longtime songwriting partner, Marcel East, at his studio. And it was myself, Morris Pleasure, and Steen Cued on acoustic guitar, because Morris played bass and piano when we recorded. So usually Morris and I would go in and just do the bass and the drums, and I would come back and, or he would come back and play piano on top. So that was the beginning of Audio Caviar. And the title of the CD was Transoceanic. My wife had just arrived. Hello, dear, how are you?
hello to the wife.
Shelly says hello. She's wearing your mask. Yeah, hello. She's wearing your mask. So that was Audio Caviar. The CD was called Transoceanic, and I think it can still be found in places. And so We had a good time with that. It was a great experience.
You know? Okay. And one of the songs you did was titled "Love Comes in Time," featuring
Love Comes Mr. in Time. Howard Hewitt. We did it with Howard Hewitt. Yes.
Nice.
Pardon me. And that was written by myself and Marcel East.
Okay. Yeah. Well, do you mind if we play a little bit of video of that song?
Oh, carry on. Do your thing. You know, I'm just visiting. You know.
Yeah, we're celebrating you today.
Yeah. Yes.
Hold on. I believe, hold on, we got a little difficulty. Again, I'll take care of it. Give me 1 second.
Give me a minute here.
Yeah.
It's the great thing about a live show.
It's live.
Sometimes, right. Sometimes our Wi-Fi goes in and out, but I got it. Here we go, guys. Hang tight.
Okay. Yep.
All right.
Hold on to your dreams. No matter what they say. God will light the way. Just lift it up and pray.
Did y'all hear those bass licks?
Ooh, nice.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's the great. Absolutely. I think that was Verdeen playing on that.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Wow. I heard a couple of licks just in that 30 seconds or so. That kind of
goofy. Yeah, most of the material was written by Marcel East and myself. Mm-hmm. There was a couple of covers. When we did a quick thing on All Blues on there. We did a thing on The Island, which George Duke was playing piano on. But we had a lot of fun putting that CD together. The artist that did the cover for the CD was Marito Suzuki. And I would later introduce him to Maurice, and Maurice would use him on some projects later on in our career.
Awesome, man.
The feel on that song.
Thank you for playing that, because that's one of my... You know, I've written a lot of stuff, but that's one of my all-time favorite tunes.
I tell you, I mean, I love the feel of that song. You know?
Thank you.
I love the feel of that.
Feel free to cover it.
Checks in the mail.
Yeah, well, hey, you might do that.
You know what's funny? You know, you never know what's going to stick and what's not. And I can tell you that song still shows up on my ASCAP foreign statements.
Oh, nice!
Somebody in the world is playing that song.
Right,
so absolutely.
It's great. Nice. I appreciate it. You know, but thank you very much. Thank you. Yeah, cool. Thank you.
Our pleasure. Yeah.
We know that teaching is a passion of yours.
Yeah,
and that I think you did a master's class for 2 days in Washington D.C. at the Duke Ellington School of Arts.
Oh man, yeah. We did a fundraiser for Duke Ellington School of the Arts, and it was by way of Rory Pullins, who was running the school back then. Mm-hmm. He's now out here in LA doing some other things that we're still engaged in. And of course, you know, when you have, I guess you could say, artists of our caliber coming to do something for you, you want to know if that artist will come back and maybe hang out with the students and share some things. And, you know, Rory presented the question, and I said, well, I would love to come back and work with the drummers. So I would fly back, like in the middle of the week, spend a couple of days with them, and then come right back to LA. And I did that a few times. And then anytime we were in the city, I would visit the school, and I became known as Uncle Ralph. You know, so, Duke Ellington School of the Arts, man, a great school. Great
that's
school.
Great. And then I think in 2007, you did a Grammy camp.
Yes, we did a Grammy camp. Yep.
How was that? What was that like?
It was fun, man. It was fun. You know, You don't see me on the kit on stage, but I still keep my drum chops up, believe me. Yeah. And The Grammy camp was a lot of fun, you know, because I got to sit on the drum set and do some stuff, you know.
Well, you know what?
Uh-oh.
Well, we want to see you.
We want to see you. Right?
You don't believe me, huh?
That's right.
Good. Hey, that's good stuff.
I wonder if I can still play that stuff.
You can.
Hey, I'm good.
Paradiddle.
Our good friend Drew Schultz loves you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Drew is on, I believe.
Drew,
yeah.
And I think Drew is on.
What's up, Drew?
Drew's in.
Go left.
Is Drew in the house?
Go left foot.
Yeah.
Drew. That high.
Thank you, Drew.
Drew
is one of my students. I can't take credit for everything he does.
Yeah,
I would not do that. But Drew is an incredible drummer and an incredible teacher. You know, and so we get together. Drew and I try and get together once a week, and we actually have a webinar coming up, probably the first weekend in September, where we're just going to spend a couple of hours online and share some of our thoughts about drums and rhythm. And
nice.
What have you? So I'm looking very forward to that.
We got you. Now,
yeah, great.
We'll get to that one later. But for right now, you have a very unique hobby, and that is you have like a ham radio set up in your house. What can you explain to the people?
It's a radio.
Ham radio.
Ham radio. It's a radio service that is supervised by the FCC, mm-hmm. and so unlike CB radio, which you have with a lot of truck drivers, you have to be tested to become a ham radio operator. And the cool thing is that once you get your license, you can speak to anybody in the world.
Whoa.
You know? And I hold the highest license you can hold. It's extra class license. Because when you first become a ham, you're what they call a technician. Then from there, you go to what they call a general license, and then from there, if you just want to do some stuff to just brag about, you become what they call an expert. So I say, well, I feel like bragging, so I'll just crack down, study the questions, and become an extra. But the thing is, the tests, all of these tests, are only about 30 to 35 questions.
Right.
Okay, you test before a board. There are people sitting out there who are going to grade your paper. But the thing is, the questions that are on the test come from a question pool of 800 questions.
Okay.
So you don't know which
question. What 35?
So you got to know.
What 35?
You
got to
know,
you got to know
your stuff. You got to know it if you're going to pass the test. And so, you know, I passed the test. And I originally checked this out. I became a ham because in 1999, I kept hearing that Y2K, you remember the whole Y2K mm-hmm. thing?
Oh yeah.
Said, oh, man, the computers are gonna stop, man, and the phone service and this gonna fall apart. I said, well, mm-hmm. I tell you what, I will not be out of communication. So I'm gonna get a ham license and I'll be ready. If this whole communications thing, the phones go out, I'm gonna talk to somebody. Because I'm gonna tell you something. When you're in a disaster situation, you could start to think your mind will play trick, and you could start to think you're the only one out there. So being able to communicate with someone else that's in that same situation helps you get through the situation. So whenever there's a disaster on the planet, the ham radio operators are up and running, you know. So, you know, that's really why I became a ham. And, you know, I bring out my radio every now and then and just do a little listening and see what's going on out here in the airwaves. And it's just one of those, you know, once again, it was one of those things I was interested in doing. I'd say, well, let me go ahead and do this. You know, so there you go.
Believe it or not, Ray Charles was also a ham operator.
Wow.
Oh, really? Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
He was blind, yeah. Wow. Of course, he was blind the whole time, but he got off into it. I was reading the book on his life story, and he mentioned that's what he would do, you know.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And each ham has their own very unique call sign. I would give you mine, except that if you go to what they call the ULS, which stands for the Universal Licensing System, which is where the FCC keeps a list of all ham radio operators, and you can tell if their license is current or not. Your address is attached to that call sign.
Okay.
You know, but yeah, it's quite a hobby, radio service, and you know, I love being a part of that particular community.
That's awesome.
Well,
yeah.
Okay. You know, our own amazing Philip Bailey introduces you in the show, and he always says, but we call him Slick. For all my life, I've been wondering how you got the name, who named you that, and when.
That goes way back to the early days.
Okay, let's hear it.
And, that's when I was doing my little antics in the hotel with the phone systems and making calls, but leaving other names.
I know that.
No. Yeah.
Semi-fraudulent. But, and so they started, after I got busted for it, they started calling me Slick.
Okay.
Wow.
That's how that came about.
You know? One thing answered. Next, you always perform very serious martial arts at the end of the show.
Ah.
Ooh. And how did you get involved, and how many belts do you have, and what's it called?
Okay. Wow. That's with my son, who outranks me. He's a second degree in a style that I started in called Tong Sudo, which is a Korean style of karate. I'm a first degree. Okay. He's now a second degree.
Okay.
But this was taken at the Kung Fu studio. And to answer your question, I have two black belts. Okay. I'm a first degree black belt in Tong Sudo, which I learned at Sherman Oaks Karate when they had a studio over there, which previously was a Chuck Norris studio. Okay. Then in 98, I started studying a style of Kung Fu known as San Su, S-A-N-S-O-O. And I'm a third degree black belt in that. So that bow you see me do at the end of the show is a bow we do to salute each other in San Su. And, you know, before COVID jumped on us, I would be at the dojo, you know, usually on a couple of nights a week, just working on my stuff, you know. So that's how I got started with that.
Bet that really keeps you in shape, I'm sure.
Well, yeah, when you're doing it consistently, yes. Mm-hmm. I noticed that when I started taking karate, that I actually got stronger on the drums, especially my legs. So so it's one of those things I love to do. And I actually, I used to teach self-defense. My instructor at Mark Zacharatis at San Su would say, hey, you want to come in and teach a class on self-defense? And I would go in, I'd invite couples in, you know, husband and wives, whatever. Mm-hmm. And I would teach them how to get out of certain holes and what to do if this happens. And, you know, which is something, once again, I enjoy doing. So.
Thank you.
Something else our viewers at home may not know about you is that you also, I hear you play a mean game of tennis as well.
I learned tennis over at Rancho Park over there by Dorsey High School. Learned from a gentleman by the name of Richard Williams, not to be confused with the Williams sister's father. I learned this in 76 and started playing with Reese, used to play with Reese a little bit. Mm. And we would play up at Carmel, in his place up at Carmel.
Okay.
And I love tennis. And so today still, every Wednesday morning, I'm a member at Calabasas Tennis and Swim Center over here. And every Wednesday morning at 8 a.m., I'm on the court for an hour working out with my instructor, still working. Because
nice.
It's a, you know, man, look, anything you do well is going to be a lifetime study. I tell people that play musical instruments,
mm-hmm.
you don't get to a certain point and just say, well, I've arrived, and so that's all I'll learn about that. No.
Very true.
It becomes a lifetime study, and you just continue to learn. So, yeah, I love to play. I love hitting that tennis ball. I absolutely love it.
Yeah, I may have to go back and pick my racket up.
Pick it up.
We got a little dust on it.
Let's get going, you know. Yeah. And I actually carry my racket. When we're on summer tour, I carry my rackets on the road. And when we have an off day, mm-hmm. I have management call up the local tennis center. And I spend time at least 2 hours with an instructor just working on my strokes.
Yeah.
Wow.
So,
that's awesome, man. Yeah.
So, hey, I have a love for drums as well. That was my first instrument, you know, growing up, you know, watching Benny Benjamin, not watching him, but hearing on records and stuff like that.
Benny Benjamin, one of the Motown drummers.
Yes. Pistol Pete. I used to go over to Pistol Pete's house and sit behind that set when I was in junior high school.
And the other drummer was Uriel Jones.
Yes, Uriel Jones.
There were three Motown drummers.
That's right.
And I actually met Pistol in Detroit when we played, because he had met up with a student of mine that goes by the name of Zorro, who played behind Bobby Brown and Lenny Kravitz.
Uh-huh.
And now he's a student I will take credit for all the way. And he turned out to be a great student because he went on to do some great things. And so I met Pistol in Detroit, and we had a great conversation, man. I had nothing but questions about the whole Motown thing. It was a fascinating, fascinating conversation.
You know? What I learned when I used to go up to his house, they taught me how to play that, heard it through the grapevine beat, you know, boom, ba da da boom.
Right.
My God, so this how y'all did it? So,
yeah.
But this brings me to this fabulous snare drum that you have.
Uh-oh.
Yes.
Yeah. The DW Earth, Wind, and Fire snare drum.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, that's their copy. That picture was taken at the Memphis drum store in Memphis. Mm-hmm. Incredible drum store. Mm-hmm. I mean, incredible. They got a cymbal vault, which is incredible. I mean, you walk in, they got gongs. I mean, it's all laid out. But throughout the shop on the upper shelves, they have a tremendous display of African art.
Okay.
I mean, some serious stuff, man. And, but yeah, the Memphis Drum Shop in Memphis is where that picture was taken. And I remember I did a little video promo for them for that snare drum. And I am proud to say DW endorse E. Shout out to John Good and all the crew up there. And great drums, man. The engineering and the care that goes into a DW drum set is tremendous. I love my DW drums.
I think we have a clip of you speaking about it, talking about it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
This is the Earth, Wind snare drum that DW has just put out. The graphics on here that you see on here, this is all wood inlay. This is not decal or paint. It's an 11-ply shell, what John Good calls HTLV maple. And it's a great snare.
As I tell you, John was once our drum tech.
John cares about drums. Let that be known. See, John goes on these trips, man. That's why the wood at DW is so exotic. He goes on these trips. His latest thing is almond. Who'd have thought it? Almond wood shells. But that's what they featured at the 2019 NAMM show. John goes on these trips all over the world looking for that very special wood. And that's why the drums have such a unique look. He gave this snare drum to me last year when we played Vegas in May. And he brought it up. He says, man, I got something for you. And he brought it out and gave it to me. I said, wow, it's beautiful. And finally, at this year's NAMM show, in Anaheim. He presented and people love it. It's a beautiful snare. Everybody sees it goes, wow, that's a great, great looking snare. This is a long time coming. I'm proud of this.
Nice. Nice. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
That's beautiful.
John, yeah, John Good was once our drum tech.
Okay.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And then he split away, and next thing I know, he was up there at DW Drums. Excuse me. Him and Don Lombardi. Shout out to Don.
All right.
And, you know, he just kept going with DW, and what a success story, you know.
Nice.
Well, anybody that knows you well knows that you are a wine connoisseur. There it is.
Oh.
So what are you drinking lately? And what should we know?
Look at kid.
Lately I've been drinking Zinfandel. I started because, as you know, if you're into wine, Cabernets are very heavy. But a Zinfandel is a nice cross between a Pinot and a Cab.
Mm-hmm.
So I started experimenting with the Zinfandels, you know.
Well,
but I enjoy a nice Pinot Noir.
Right.
Also, which is a lighter red, you know. So
Well, I'm glad you like Zinfandels, because I have a wine that I want to introduce to you. This is called Earth, Zen, and Fire.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God. Look at you.
I'll be sending one of these to you in lieu of payment for the show.
Oh, no.
That's always a great term. You know what? In lieu of payment, I will look for. Thank you. I'm very much into Zinfandels, and I will look forward to receiving that, and I will savor it and let you know my thoughts on it.
Absolutely. Exactly. I understand.
How do you, Michelle? How do you like? How do you like?
I do like it, but I don't know. I like this wine called Opolo, and I'll have to send you one of those too. And,
okay.
And it's a Zin also. They're a little sweeter, aren't they?
Zins, yeah, they can be. Yes.
A little,
but I don't want to. I would never characterize it as a sweet wine, because.
Right.
If you have a sweet wine, it's usually a dessert wine, like a port.
Or something very cheap, like Acadama.
Yeah, now you're talking, you know.
But I like Acadama, so, you know, who am I?
Strawberry Hill, you know.
Strawberry Hill, right.
Yeah, Boone Farm.
Boone Farm,
yeah.
Hey,
I'm talking about, you know.
Oh, my God.
Get a glass of that.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah.
Well, you also are an avid art collector. And I wanted to know some of the pieces you like, some of the artists you like. I hear about it a lot in this house, so I'm bringing it out.
Yeah, I in 76, 77, I had an accountant that introduced me to limited edition prints, and it just started a whole thing. And my wife and I have been collecting since about 76. And my house, if you come to my home, you will see that there's art all over the walls, you know.
I remember.
But I'll show you. Let me go grab something and show you something very special.
All right.
Cool. Let me just take a move.
All right, nice.
Yeah, while he's doing that, ladies and gentlemen, subscribe to our YouTube channel and subscribe to our Facebook page.
Absolutely. And
that's my story.
Do
you know who this is?
Yeah. Okay, what is it?
Do you know who this is? That is a picture of who?
I don't know personally.
President? No, let me see.
No. That is the great Pablo Picasso.
Oh, wow, man. Okay.
Wow.
Pablo Picasso, that is his signature right here at the top. He signed it.
Oh, wow.
And this was given to me, Shelly, by our great friend Paxton Baker.
Paxton, okay.
Nice.
Okay. Well, we're in a pandemic, so, you know.
Yes,
we might be able to sell that.
Yes, you gotta kill it handy.
But the collection is not just prints, it's also African sculpture. It's also books. I have a beautiful set of Marc Chagall books, Marc Chagall lithograph books. Look up Marc Chagall.
Okay.
The thing about the Marc Chagall books is that to find them in excellent condition is very hard. But when Marc Chagall did his books, back then when people were doing what they call the catalog resume, it's a collection of his work. He decided he would do something very special with his books. He decided that the front dust cover would be a real lithograph. And inside the first two books, there are about 10 lithographs that he actually did to put in the book. So art dealers have been known to take just the dust covers, frame them, and sell them for a very high amount of money. But I have the Marc Chagall lithograph books as part of my collection. And it's a cool thing to say that you have, because if you try and buy a Marc Chagall original oil, you could be out $100,000 or more. I have a set of Marc Chagall books, and I hear
you have one of the largest collection in the world of Paul Smith socks.
What is that? Wow.
Indeed, the world's largest collection.
Wow.
I've got, let me tell you, I tell you what, and I haven't counted them.
Yeah.
But well over 100 pairs of Paul Smith socks.
Yep.
Because I like graphics. I like graphics. Mm-hmm. I like graphics. You know, mm-hmm. I like color and I like graphics. And so that's why I started collecting. And it just became a thing. And the other, once you start down that road, man, you just keep collecting and you just can't stop. Yeah. You know, so that was great, Shell. Thank you. Yeah. You guys aren't messing around.
No, sir. I even know
that you did all the driving back in the day, because Philip got lost and Verdeen can't drive, so it fell on you.
Back in the station wagon days, as we called them.
Yeah,
I was one of the designated drivers, but I enjoyed driving. I didn't mind. So it could be night or day. You could put me behind the wheel, and I'd just sit there and drive until we got to where we had to go. So it really wasn't a big thing.
Okay, my last order of business is that there's a running joke on this show that the producer and these guys say that I managed to work Verdeen White into every single episode. And so they said they were going to start fining me if I mention his name. I'm going to pass the fine along to you. I have to, because I wanted all the viewers to know that you were the one that introduced us. And so I'll kill you later, but
that is true, because when I was in the studio with Shell, I had the guys, Larry Dunn, Al McKay.
Everybody. Maurice was there.
Playing on these tracks.
Man. Yeah,
so I introduce Shelly and Dean. So, I'm that guy.
Yeah, see, I'm guilty.
Well, listen,
I wanted to publicly thank you for that. Anyway, go ahead, Midas.
Okay.
Yeah, you're more than welcome. Yeah.
Now, Ralph, I understand that you also had a family member that helped make it possible for Earth, Wind, and Fire to receive a doctorate of music.
Yes, my late great Aunt Marge. That was Aunt Marge that helped put that together.
Mm-hmm.
And she helped. She helped. She very much spearheaded that whole move with Eric Winston. Mm-hmm. And I forget the other name, forgive me, but she definitely spearheaded that, and we went on, received our doctorates, and it was a really cool day. Well, in Chicago.
I must say you have done some really amazing things in your lifetime.
Man.
I tell people that I have been very blessed. First off, I came from a great family.
Yeah, that's first and foremost.
I came from a family that was very supportive.
Mm-hmm.
Always. We were a tight family. And so, I tell people that I've been very blessed. You know, I was drafted into Earth, Wind, and Fire. You know, the audition, when I auditioned for Earth, Wind, and Fire, was just myself, Verdeen, and that's at that time the guitar player Michael Beal, and he was part of the original Earth, Wind, and Fire, and you know, we did the audition in Baldwin Hills at Michael's house, and all we did was jam. It was just the three of us, we just jammed. And so Verdeen called Maurice, and Maurice said, "Well, so what do you think?" And Dean said, "No, he's the cat. Let's do this. Let's move forward." So I was drafted. I was drafted into Earth, Wind. I have never looked back. I feel blessed. Feel honored to be such a part. And when I leave here, I will leave behind a great legacy.
Absolutely.
With Earth, Wind, and Fire. But it has been an incredible run. We're still doing stuff. We haven't, you know, we're not going away, you know, but it's been a real cool ride. You know,
You guys have garnered so many awards. I think the one that sticks out to me, I was watching TV one night and you guys were accepting the Kennedy Center. Oh my God. And I'm that really, I mean, it made me proud, you know, because whenever I see this, I see some actor, some opera singer, but to see that award was fantastic, man. And for those who missed it, we do have a clip of that.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't let you talk about it.
Welcome back to the Kennedy Center Honors.
It's been a fantastic night of tributes. And there's one more special performance as we say goodnight. So, to Kennedy Center honorees, Linda, Sally, Sesame Street, MTT, Philip, Ralph, and Verdeen, and we can't forget Maurice, we celebrate you with the music of Earth, Wind, and Fire. All right, everybody, let's party just a little bit more.
That was a very, very special weekend in Washington, D.C. From the time that you get off the plane, they have you and they are guiding you around. They're giving you your schedule.
Oh, I can imagine.
Shelly will tell you. And it was just a super duper special weekend. When John Legend opened up with Can't Hide Love, he absolutely killed that song. And I was like, John, really?
Yeah, he did a good
job. And it was just, you know, it's the highest honor an artist can receive in the United States of America. It's equivalent to being knighted in the UK. You know, so once again, one of those very special blessings, and it was an honor. It was an absolute honor. We had such a great time.
Amen.
You know, so, you know, that one, that's special. That's very, very special.
You're right. Gotta give him that.
Yes, you know, but that was super, super duper special.
Well, I'm gonna get in trouble for this again, but last week, Verdine was on a call that included Gil Garcetti. And he wanted, you may have been on that one too. I don't know.
I was on it.
He was reminding everybody that there is going to be Earth, Wind, and Fire Day coming up pretty soon. Mm. And September 21st, because of you all's song. I wanted to remind you too, Ralph, that it's also Earth, Wind, and Fire Day in Chicago. Mayor Rahm Emanuel declared that maybe 4 years ago.
Okay.
So that's your day too, and it is here. And I think we have a clip of all of that.
Oh, wow.
Well, we might want to start off today's council meeting. These folks need no introduction.
Ladies, members, Mr. President, Angelinos in the gallery, it is my great honor and privilege today to bring to this council and to the city one of the greatest bands ever assembled in the history of the United States, the one and only Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Yeah!
We celebrate this month, the month of September. Today, our action and this occasion is to declare September 21st, as called out in the song September. From this September 21st forward, Earth, Wind, and Fire Day in the city of Los Angeles. But this band, at a time when the country was going through lots and lots of strife, this brand brought culture, brought togetherness, brought internationalism, brought Afrocentricity to the eyes of everyday people across the country and across the world, mixing Brazilian music and Latin American music and African music and American music into an amalgamation of what we now know as the Earth, Wind, and Fire sound. We are joined by three of our original members here that I want to call up and hear a few words from. First, I want to introduce our own. This is the LA homeboy, born and raised here in the city of Los Angeles, Ralph Johnson.
Thank you, Mark. Welcome. Welcome.
Thank you so very much. Good morning, LA City Council. I cannot begin to tell you how special this moment is for me. I am a product of LAUSD. I went to 24th Street Elementary School, Mount Vernon Junior High School. I grew up on 28th and Hobart, okay? And let me also say that the Honorable Mr. Curran Price and I went to Morningside High School together in Inglewood, you know? And I'll tell those off the record later. But this is really a very incredible moment. It's one thing to receive a proclamation in a city where you live, but to receive it in a city where you were born and raised. I'm very proud of the fact that I'm from Los Angeles, California. And this is starting off a very special week for us, because on Friday and Saturday we will play the iconic Hollywood Bowl with the Hollywood Bowl Orchestra. And we are very, very excited about that. So I just want to let all of you know that we are indeed incredibly honored. Next year, 2020, will be our 50-year anniversary in the entertainment business. And I can think of no better way to start the celebration just a little bit early than with today's ceremonies. Thank you so very much.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Hey.
Congratulations.
You're a beautiful speaker.
Thank
you. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow. Thank you. Thank you so much. That means a lot. That means a lot. You know? Hey, maybe I'll start a new career. I'll be a motivational speaker.
You got it.
Wait, you see what we're doing?
Yeah, I can dig it. You know, But no, that was indeed a very special moment. My proclamations are up in the front room here, yeah, that was very special. That was very special. But to have that happen, to be from L.A.
Right, you know, right. I think you did most of the talking that day because it was appropriate, you know.
Well, thank you, Shell. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, it was definitely very special. And then we went on that weekend, man, and crushed.
Oh,
the Hollywood Bowl.
That was great.
Oh, wow.
Crushed it with the orchestra. That's nice. That's one of our favorite dates to do, the Hollywood Bowl with the orchestra. It is just a beautiful, beautiful night of great music. It really is.
That's great.
I'm glad for those kind of venues. We might have to start having more next year of the outdoor type venues.
Yes, absolutely.
You know, with the way things are.
Yes.
But speaking of performing, there's a very exciting part of the show when you and Philip Bailey do a bit of a drum duel. It's not really a duel, but it's just great. It's back and forth. I want to take a second to see if we can show that clip.
Uh-oh, look out.
Okay, this is cool.
Well, I certainly remember that. We were down in South America, you know, at Viña del Mar. Yeah, it's a festival that takes place. I think it was Venezuela, I believe.
Okay.
And we were playing a music festival, and that was a great night. That was a great night. You know?
Yeah.
You
thank you for that. Yes.
I just want to remind our audience at home that we will be having a question and answer segment. We're going a little over our normal time tonight, but I think that's all right.
Let it run, Ralph.
You asked, is the show what? Is it about an hour? And I want, yeah, right. We can fit your 60-year career. 1 hour show.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, well, all right. No, but this is great, and I'm having a ball. And no, we can run for it. Look, as long as you like, it doesn't matter to me. Let me go back to something because I want to touch on the wine thing for just a second because. Shell, you were saying you like Zinfandels.
Yes.
There is a great Zinfandel. The label is Carlisle. C-A-R-L. Carlisle. C-A-R-L-I-S-L-E. And they make a great Zinfandel. Mm. Trust me.
Okay.
I was turned on to this by John Clayton, bass player John Clayton, who's now part of the family.
He's your
because
family.
My youngest son, Mark Anthony, married John Clayton's daughter, Gina Clayton. So now you know.
Right.
Cool. All right. Yeah. So, guys at home, just hang tight. We will get into.
Yes.
I know you guys are dropping questions, but we will get to that segment here shortly. So, y'all just be patient. Yeah. We're getting
hold
there.
On,
okay. Yeah. So, Mr. Ralph, one of your best projects that's still talked about is a Christmas CD that you did with Miss Syeda Garrett.
Well, I didn't. It wasn't a whole CD. It was just this one song.
Oh, okay. Just one song. All right. A single.
Yeah, it was a single, and it's called Have a Very Merry Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
And it's myself, Raymond Crosley, who's an incredible writer, used to be with Motown and did a lot of stuff there, brought the track over, and we sat there, and I listened, and I just came up with this hook, Have a Very Merry Christmas. So I went in the studio with kind of a rough version of the vocal stuff. I then said, okay, you know what, man? I knew we had worked with Syeda on The Promise,
mm-hmm.
My Promise to You, which was on the Now, Then, and Forever CD.
Right.
I said, man, you know what? I'm going to call Syeda Garrett and ask if she'll do this tune. And so Syeda went on and finished writing the lyrics. And so it's one of the coolest things. I listen to it even if it's not. I was just listening to it the other night, even if it's not Christmas, because it turned out so cool.
Right.
And once again, thanks and props to Raymond Crosley, who's just a prolific writer. As a matter of fact, I'm getting ready to release something on him on the smooth jazz side on my label, One Off Records. But it was Ray that came up with that track, and we just kind of all came together, myself, Ray, Saida, and Saida's husband, Eric Nuri. And it really turned out cool. It is actually, it is one of my, I've done a lot of production, but this, the Christmas song, is one of my favorite productions. And the other thing is, writing a Christmas song was on my bucket list.
Bucket list, okay.
I still have a couple more items on my bucket list.
Sure, maybe one or two, huh?
Yeah, because I only, so far, I've only had three. But as a writer, publisher, I wanted to write a great Christmas song.
Okay.
Strange thing to have on a bucket list. Yeah. The other two things are, I want to go for a ride with the Navy Blue Angels. Because they do have these rides they'll take you on. And the other thing is, I want to strap on my scuba tank, go down to the Sea of Cortez, and go scuba diving with the manta rays.
Because I also
scuba dive.
Okay, man, you jack of many trades once again. But well, back to you.
Look, go ahead. You know, you gotta keep busy.
Yeah, right.
How do you think this show came about? You know,
exactly.
You guys put this show together. You guys did this. You guys are doing this, and you know, it's right on time.
Yes.
So thank you. Once again, bravo. Hats off.
Yeah.
You were on our bucket list. So
glad I made the list.
You know? Yeah. And I heard you. Oh, go ahead, Shelly. I'm sorry.
No, I was gonna say. When we were last week, Bernine said, you know who would be great for the show? I said, Ralph Johnson. I said, Ralph, no, he'll never do it. He'll never do this. He'll do the show. I said, he won't do the show. He'll do the show.
Shelly, you didn't think I would do the show?
We're not professionals at this, and I know.
No. But it's about. But it's a family.
It's the vibe.
It's the vibe. You know. Yeah. So no, I wouldn't. How can I turn you down? Come on, get ready.
Thank you, and thank you. We thank you again. Anyway, I'm
But anyway, I digress. So yeah, that Christmas song. It's a very special song. It's one of my favorite productions. Saida, great job delivering it. And there you go.
Yeah. And I heard you say you like to listen to it sometimes, even though it's not Christmas time.
I swear to you, just two nights ago, I was listening to it and just going, wow, man.
Yeah.
That's something to be proud of.
Yeah. Well, we're about to do the same thing.
Yay.
You wouldn't listen to it,
even though it's not Christmas time.
Hey,
Man, nice. thank you for that. I'm like, okay, let's go out to Christmas. Yeah.
I'm in the mood.
Man, but no, let me say something about working with the incredible Syeda Garrett. She is just such a beautiful, warm, engaging spirit. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so, you know, it was a joy to be able to work with her. And I went back, I said, okay, you got a Christmas song, but that's a seasonal thing. You need to write one more thing that they can play throughout the year. So I went back one night, I was in my studio and I was, you know, every now and then I go down there and I listen to things that are maybe not completed or finished so I can see what work there is to be done. Right. And so I was done listening and I came up with this idea about your aura, A-U-R-A. Mm-hmm. And I sat down and I started toying around with lyrics. Then I came up with kind of a chordal sketch, which I then sent to Marcel East, my longtime writing partner, who, by the way, is the younger brother of Nathan East, the bass player. The whole East family is super talented. But I sent it to him. He sent me back these incredible chords. We finished it all up. I sent it. Mind you, I'm never in the studio with Syeda when she's doing her vocals. I send her the track. She goes in with her engineer. They send me back the vocals. I import them in to the master mix over here. And then we just go from there. But the tune is called Aura, Embrace Your Light.
Oh, okay.
You know? And I said I had to have something that could play, pardon me, all year long and not just for the holiday season. You know?
Understandable.
So
Understandable.
I have two things on Syeda, and I love them both. And I love her.
Great
artist.
Yes, she is.
Yeah,
yes,
great artist.
And can write, can really write.
Okay. You know? Well, man, let me just say this. Yesterday in our virtual green room, I got on late and I heard you talking about silver, investing in silver. Can you explain?
Guess it's time for me to get on my soapbox.
Get on your soapbox.
Wait, be careful. We got Tazz.
Yeah, we got to get on the good foot.
Get on the good foot. She made full of plug.
Let me just say this. The United States is headed for an economic collapse. Now, you're not going to hear this on mainstream news. They're not going to talk about it. It's just going to happen. The dollar is steadily spiraling downward, okay? And so you have to protect yourself against what is coming, because I'm telling you, when it goes down, it will be of biblical proportion. Like,
talk about
the world, this thing will be so big when it collapses, they're referring to it as the GCR, the Global Currency Reset, okay? So you have to protect yourself. Because the dollar is what we call a fiat currency. The value that is placed on the dollar is placed on by law or regulation. There's nothing backing. There was a time when the dollar was backed by gold. Well, that all went away. So now you just have essentially paper and ink. And what keeps the dollar propped up is the fact that it is the world reserve currency. That is, when countries do business with each other, they're doing it in dollars. They don't do it in Swiss francs. It's not Japanese yen, and it ain't German marks. It's the dollar. But it was Ben Bernanke who was once the head of the Federal Reserve, which, by the way, the Federal Reserve has nothing to do with the United States government. The Federal Reserve is as federal as FedEx. Okay, the Federal Reserve, most people don't know, the Federal Reserve is a privately owned company. It came into existence December 23rd, 1913. Mm. Okay. And now you have these central banks all over the world. Mm-hmm. Okay. And they control that. So if you're going to protect yourself against what's coming with our economy, you need to be buying. Now, hold it. Let me say this. I am not an accountant. Disclaimer. Disclaimer. Got to get it in.
Yeah.
I'm not an accountant. I'm not a financial consultant. I didn't study economics, but I do have common sense. Mm-hmm. And I will tell you that this is going to happen. It is going to happen. So if all your money is tied up just in dollars. You've got dollars and $100 bills stacked up somewhere. You're actually losing money. You need that currency. And currency has no what they call stored value, whereas gold and silver are stored value. Yeah. Let me tell you something. I don't think the dollar is mentioned in the Bible, but I can tell you that gold is mentioned 417 times, and silver is mentioned 320.
Judas.
Okay, thank you. So, gold and silver are what we call God's money. And so you need to protect yourself. You really do. So what you do is you go out and you try and find this. I know it's kind of shiny, but this there's a better view. But this is 1 ounce of pure silver. This is called a silver eagle. Mm. Now they have 1 ounce coins that are called gold eagles. But if I were you, just saying, if I were you, I would take 25% of my cash stash and I would buy gold and silver, and more so silver than gold, because silver is what we call a strategic metal. We have to use silver. We have to use it. There's no getting around. When you get off this, what we're doing here, walk around your house and look at everything electrical. Mm-hmm. That's got, if you have a computer, a radio, whatever you have, a phone, the connections are silver solder. Now, let me tell you something very interesting. Unlike paper and plastic goods that we recycle, mm-hmm. we don't recycle silver. Once we throw it in the dump, that's where it stays. Now, maybe someday when it becomes very, very cost effective, they'll start pulling silver out the junkyards. But right now, we're using it up like it's going out of style, like it's growing on trees. Well, we're going to run out of it. Mm. And so I'm just saying, if I were you, by the way, don't be surprised if by January 2021, you start to hear about the United States government moving us toward a digital currency.
It's in the Bible.
Okay, a digital currency. Something like Bitcoin, although the difference between, say, Bitcoin and this digital currency that they will move us into is that still, even though they're moving us into a digital currency, they will still have the central banking system set up. So you will hear them start to offer what they call digital wallets to keep your currency in. However, there's still that third party bank. And if they can offer you a digital wallet, believe me, they know how to pull that money out of that same wallet. So I say to you, if you get into digital currency, say like Bitcoin or Litecoin or whatever your favorite might be, you never keep your digital currency on the exchange where you bought it. You take it off the exchange and you put it in your own digital wallet that you keep at home.
Wow. Okay.
And so, I'm telling you, as sure as tomorrow the sun will rise, there's going to be an economic crash, and a lot of people are going to get hurt badly. Wow. It will be something you've never seen before. I'm telling you.
Okay.
Let me step off my sofa.
We get it.
So glad you explained that. I mean, I'm going out to get me some silver tomorrow.
get as much as you can.
Thanks for the tip.
1 ounce silver eagles, that's what you want. 99.999 fine silver.
All right,
well, Ralph, I heard, just real quickly, I'll touch on this. I heard that there are some countries now that are paying by a facial recognition, and that's how you're paying for whatever it is you buy now. And so they are thinking that this is going to catch on because, you know, they can control things better. And
So you just I didn't mean to cut you off, Shell, but you just said the magic word, control.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Ultimately, the global elite, whoever they are, want control
of everything.
And I'm gonna just say one other thing, then I'll step down off the soapbox. Be careful when people start coming to you talking about, yeah, we got this new vaccine. Oh, really? Well, what's in the vaccine?
They don't, can't tell you that part.
I'm telling you, be careful.
Yeah.
Very, very careful. All right, so now I'm off my soapbox.
Okay.
And we're back to lighter things.
So off the soapbox, back to the good flip.
Let's talk about some of your current projects. I want to hit again on the drum webinar, drum clinic you're doing, so we can throw a link up.
We're going to do myself and Drew Schultz. We'll do, myself and Drew Schultz will do a webinar in September on the 5th.
Weekend. Right.
And I'm just coming off my second smooth jazz single, which featured the piano playing of Gerald Clayton, who's now in the family. And that's called Smooth in You. So you can find it on your favorite, download site. I'm about to do a release on Raymond Crosley. That's called Smooth Delicious. And just trying to, keep busy and keep things moving forward and stay positive and try and encourage others to do the same. Stay positive, because I have a feeling there's some of you sitting out there that haven't discovered your inner talent. Mm-hmm. But we all have a talent. You know, I was once told that I have two special skills. One is being able to teach, and I found that to be true. Once I learn it, I can teach it to you. Yes. But the other thing I have is I'm able to exhort. The word exhort means to advise or counsel. And so if I lay out some information, usually I'm pretty much spot on about it, and if people listen, they can sometimes come out better when everything starts to go crazy. they're just a couple of what I call spiritual gifts, teaching and the gift of exhortation. So
very good. Spiritual gifts are wonderful, man.
I'm glad you brought up Smooth and You, because we just so happen to have a little audio.
They asked for it in the comments too.
That just touches on, pardon me, what Gerald Clayton as a pianist can really do. He is go online, go on YouTube, and look at Gerald Clayton, man. He can play some piano. I'm gonna give him a plug. He's got a new CD out, which he did live at the Village Vanguard in New York City, and it's incredible.
I gotta do my homework.
He's the absolute truth.
Yeah, man. I love it.
Thank you.
Guess what it's time for now, ladies and gentlemen?
Uh-oh.
Time for questions and answers. We in 2 hours already. Ralph, you might have the record for the longest show, actually. We had some people that was an hour 30, hour 40. Yeah. We just officially hit to 7:59 right now. We just hit 2 hours.
We're just on the surface.
And it looks like I'm looking at the comments. I'm looking at what my mom and my sister is saying. I think Facebook, due to you guys' content, you know, some of the songs and copyrights, Facebook may have stopped showing in certain areas. A lot of people are on YouTube now, but now's the time we're about to scroll some of these questions and pop them up on the screen. And ladies and gentlemen, if there's something you want to ask at home, please let us know. We're about to start combing here.
All right. Okay.
All right. Let me see what we got here. Me and Taz. Shout out to Taz also, by the way.
Taz in the background. How you doing, Taz?
Yeah.
Leave her back there.
She's nice to Ralph.
Yeah. Taz and Shelly work so hard behind the scenes. Melissa, woo, Lewandowski. Did I nail it?
Melissa. Okay.
Yeah. Shelly, I love that wine glass. Where can I get one?
Okay. We got to hook her up after
Ms.
the show.
Yeah, Miss,
you guys are going to have to start manufacturing the glasses.
Yeah, we're working on that.
You know, you got to have some swag, you know. Swag. So wine glasses.
Yeah.
You know what that stands for? Swag.
What, swag? No, I don't.
Swag. It means stuff we all get.
Okay. I love something.
Never knew it. Shelly, be a tip. We all get.
Yeah, teaching me something.
Yep.
Man, let's see. I'm looking for questions. There's so many comments up here. My friend Brooke over in the UK again. What's the most nervous you've been during your career?
Ooh.
Wow. That's a very good question.
That's a good one.
That is a good question. And you know what? I'm going to say when we played, there's an event that takes place in London, England every year in the park called the Proms.
Okay.
It's a big musical event. It really is. And so that was our first time appearing there. So I might have been a little nervous, but in general, I don't get nervous about our performances. I just, once Philip hit counts it off, we go.
Go with it.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know.
Let's see.
What do we got?
Linda Lane, that's a good friend of the show. Hey, Taz. Let's see. There's a lot. I went back to the top. Some of the questions are rhetorical, or we already answered them.
No. How about the one from Drew Schultz?
It's Allison.
Can you pop it up, Ken? No.
Yeah, I can pop it up.
Okay, I'm still looking. Drew Schultz says, "Shout out to Drew. What's up, buddy?" Also, I don't know if Ralph remembers, but he blew my mind about UFO sightings back in the day, way before crazy footage started officially getting released by the Pentagon.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, you know, some of what's out there is our very own stuff.
Yeah, you get into that too. I see.
I can tell you that we have a craft, and you can look it up. You can Google it. It's called a TR-3B. It is a giant triangular craft that is silent and anti-gravitic. It is not affected by gravity. Mm-hmm. It could be sitting over this house right now. You'd never know it.
Really?
It's called a TR-3B.
Mm-hmm.
Google it. Go ahead and Google it.
I'm writing it down. Images.
They're giant. They're giant. And they are owned by the United States Air Force. But now not everything that is seen out there is our stuff. But I will tell you some of it is.
A lot of it is. Yeah?
Because we have moved into the era of advanced technology.
Right.
And a lot of it stays hidden away. You know,
yep.
Because imagine introducing anti-gravity crap.
Yeah.
Well, there goes the oil business and jet fuel. That all goes out the window.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so indeed. They can't. There's certain things they're just not going to tell you. You know, it is what it is. Mm-hmm.
That's the popular thing.
Yeah.
Okay, wow. We got Marcia Evans would like to know, were you affected by the birth of the ever popular Lynn drums / drum machines back in the day?
Nice question.
No, I thought that they were interesting, and there was a period when we went through that whole drum machine thing. And as a matter of fact, the tracks we cut on the Temps album, we used the Oberheim DMX, which was a drum machine that Oberheim put out. Very excellent. Mm-hmm. And I just embraced that technology I try to embrace all technology that makes sense to me.
Yeah.
And as I'm trying to figure out how I can utilize it in what I do.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Just add another layer to is my sister. Miss Faith Godbold. You see, I just wanted to say this has been the best episode of That's My Story, Mr. Johnson. Thank you for all of your exhortations. Shout out to my sister. She also runs a business called A Touch of Faith, makes all kind of decor and all of that stuff. Just give her a little
plug. Okay. Well, thank you and a pleasure meeting you.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. So you guys on Facebook, check out A Touch of Faith.
Okay.
Christmas is coming.
Yeah, Amy. Yes, it is. Once again.
Yeah.
Let's see if he's got one more.
Okay. It's getting late, huh? Still got to get my son in the bath here shortly.
Okay.
Mr. Drew Schultz says, I also second Brooke's question. What are some of the Earth, Wind, Fire deep, deep, deep cuts that Ralph wishes were better known?
Okay.
That's a very excellent question. And I'll tell you, I was on YouTube one night, and I was just searching through some Earth, Wind stuff. And I found a track. Check this out. I want you to check out a track called Milky Way.
Milky Way.
Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful track. It's a beautiful song.
Okay. You know?
And I just happened to find it. I think I was up listening to Jacob Collier. And if you don't know about Jacob Collier, you're really missing it.
Yeah.
Check out a track called Milky Way.
Okay.
All right.
Load it down.
And I think there's probably a lot of stuff on the Faces LPs, because it's a double set, that we should go back and refamiliarize ourselves with. Of course, one of my favorite songs is a tune called Sail Away.
Sail Away.
Yeah, Sail Away.
I played it last night.
Did you really?
Mm.
Wow. Beautiful tune. But I mean, it's not one we've ever done on the show.
Right.
And who knows if we'll ever do it. You know, but that's a great, great song. But I mean, Maurice was such a genius, you know, and you got to remember that all of this came out of his brain, his head. You know, he had it all mapped out, you know. And so that's why I say I'm blessed and lucky to be a part of such a very excellent musical organization.
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah, man. Yeah.
I'm still looking. It's making sure.
Come on, more questions. Come on, give me some more questions.
I know, right?
Yeah, let's see here.
Everybody's just complimenting, you know. Not too many questions specific. I think, you know, in a couple of hours, we probably covered mostly everything, and some things are rhetorical that are being mentioned. And everything's just very complimentary. I'm just making sure.
Yeah.
Are you saying it made a good impression?
Yeah.
Oh man, of course. Let's see. And Brooke had one more question, I think.
Brooke is one of our super fans from England.
From the UK.
That's right.
I think
Renee did her radio show.
This is our good buddy Charles Etcherson, aka Chuck. Let's see the Chuck type correctly today. This is another ongoing joke on the show. I told him last week you need to auto correct. Okay, no, he started out wrong.
I caught.
man, I ain't even.
All right, he says, I caught Earth, Wind, and Fire in Ypsilanti, Ann Arbor, Michigan years ago. I can't remember what member came flying through the sky onto the stage, but that was the first time I experienced that kind of choreography.
Oh, nice.
Well, I'm trying to remember who that might have been.
Yeah.
You know,
this guy.
Let me go back and review some footage. I'll get back to you on
that. Yeah, I tell you. Hey, Charles, I'm just kidding with you, buddy. You know we love it. I wouldn't do it if I, you know, you already know.
All right.
I think that's, will that be it for tonight? What are we thinking?
Any more?
Let's see. Let me. Okay, now I just got the word. We're gonna wrap the questions up.
Wrap the questions.
Yeah.
All right, we're gonna proceed to the next segment.
Okay.
So Ralph.
Well, Luckily, I think we're on the countdown, but go ahead, Ken.
Now, I was going to ask Ralph, where can we find him?
Right.
I'm on Facebook, I'm on Twitter, I'm on Instagram, you know, I'm on all the regular, there you go.
Yeah, I just sent you a friend request on Facebook.
Hit me up.
Instagram.
Yeah.
All there you that go. Stuff.
But I'm pumped. There you go. So yeah. I try to stay active on the social media side. I do understand the importance
of it. You do very well. I see you. You do well.
Well, no, you do very well, Shell.
I'm still learning, but.
Yeah, right on. Well, you're doing a fine job, let me tell you.
Yes, she is.
Yeah.
I'm just, you know, we're on the countdown now. So I just want to hit on something real quickly so we can throw a book up of yours. I'm going to say two words, Cherry Lane and John Sticks. What do you think of it?
Oh, my God, my drum book. Yes.
Yeah,
my drum exercises. You know, well, thank you very much for that. I do have a book out. I'm proud of it. But there's a story behind my book.
Yeah.
Because the first person in Earth, Wind & Fire to put out a book was Verdine White. Mm-hmm. Put out his bass book. He did with Louis Satterfield. And I looked at it and I said, shoot, I can do that. I'm going to do a drum book. And so I wound up doing a drum book. I'm very proud of it. And actually, it covers a lot of stuff. And I actually wrote it as a preparatory text for drummers coming out of high school, getting ready to go into college level playing. So mm-hmm. It covers a lot of different stuff. So mm-hmm. I'm very proud of it. I actually, when I teach, I call on certain parts of the book to teach. And, you know, it's one of those special things that's close to my heart. You know, well, I have a friend of mine that, oddly enough, I introduced him to Silver. And the minute I introduced it to him, it went up. But I say, you can't talk about it if you don't know about it.
That's right.
Indeed.
But thank you for that.
You're welcome. But what goes around comes around. You were able to introduce your publisher to Verdine and get his second volume book up. So
yes.
Reciprocal favors. And that was great. That was great. So he's got volume two out also.
There you go.
I think it's at the time where we have to remind everybody about our guest next week. He is comedian, film and TV actor, author, and singer. He has a record out. Comedian Tommy Davidson.
Yeah.
I love Tommy. Tommy is out of his mind.
Right? Yeah. Original cast member of In Living Color.
In Living Color. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yes. Another great evening.
He showed me he showed me the pilot before it ever, because I was working with him at Eddie Murphy Television on Paramount Pictures. So he showed me and Verdine the pilot before it ever came out. We said, "Oh, that's going to be a great show." You know, it was iconic, really. You know.
Nice.
Absolutely, it was a great, great show. Great casting on that show.
Yes.
Right. And one other thing, Ralph, your life is so massive that we couldn't have put this together without our girl at the Legacy, Uli Bauer, and your manager, Rhonda Vedekian. We have to send a thank you and a shout out to them.
Thank you.
Thank you, because they both do a great job.
Oh, you know? Man.
Oh, is that her? That's her right there. How do you say it? Yuli?
Yuli
B?
It's Yuli.
Yuli B.
How did you connect with guitarist Andrea Lisa for your Cold Swaggy project? All right, so Cold Swaggy was my first smooth jazz single. And it's featuring a guitarist, Andrea Lisa, who was introduced to me by, once again, Raymond Crosby. And so once I heard her play, I said, you know what, I'm going to feature you on this tune. So yeah, the tune is called Cold Swaggy, which is just some nonsensical craziness. You know, I used to get on the bus. Usually John Paris and I are the first ones on the bus. And I was sitting there on the table that sits there. And I was going, go swag it. And I just kept, he says, Ralph, you are out of your mind. I said, yeah, I know. But it turned into a song. And Andre Elise is an incredible, incredible guitarist.
Absolutely. Awesome. Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for that. Now we get to announce our website, the website that gives you shout outs by celebrities. You go into the website and choose a celebrity. There it is. Yeah. And we'll shout out anything you like. We'll curse somebody out. We'll do whatever you want.
Do what? I'm not in that package.
You don't have to be involved. We'll take care of everything. Anyway, yes, here's a word from our sponsor, Celebrity Shoutouts.
Yeah.
Hey, everybody. This is Verdeen White of Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Hey, everybody. It's Shelly Clark, formerly of the iCats and original member of the Honeycomb.
Hi, everyone. Ken Knox here from Chairmen of the Board.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Jerry Midas Hardison here representing the Chairmen of the Board as well as the executives.
We are the hosts of That's My Story.
We are proud to be part of Celebrity Shoutout.
Whether you need birthdays, anniversaries, a special occasion, or you want us to shout out to a friend, contact Celebrity
Shoutouts.
You guys at home, make sure you utilize that website, you know, for your birthdays, all your special occasions. And hopefully we're going to get Mr. Ralph Johnson to join us.
I am definitely going to do that. Yes. I thought I would do it after this.
Okay.
It's almost time for dinner.
Yeah, I know, right? You have our information. And the check's in the mail.
But I am going to do it. I definitely am going to.
Cool deal. We welcome you aboard.
Absolutely.
And we want to remind everyone at home, sorry we went over a little bit, but it's been great. Look at Taz. go ahead and go over to YouTube and like and subscribe. Make sure you do that on YouTube and on Facebook. And we just started a Twitter account. You can find us at, at S My Story That.
Okay.
And we'll have a banner for that soon, I'm sure. But at S My Story That. That's My Story was already taken. So one more time. At S My Story That. So check us out on Twitter. We're building up you know, our network over there as well, just trying to make sure we cover all the major platforms. Any closing words, guys? I definitely enjoyed Mr. Ralph Johnson this evening. Man, you hit on a lot of things. Great career. You know, you're jack of so many trades. I could only wish to do that many things throughout my career, you know, but I'm a work in progress. So you're definitely inspirational, and it's a pleasure for me to sit down with my co-host and have a chat with you. My son listens to you guys' music. And another thing I wanted to say, you guys make music that's timeless. Like, parents can listen to it with children. He's got several songs in his YouTube playlist, so you know it goes on and on, generation to generation.
Yeah. Well, let me just say, Midas, Ken, Shelly, I've had a wonderful time. This was really cool. You guys did an excellent job with your research, putting this whole thing together. And I want to say that there were a couple of points when I was surprised at some of the stuff you dug up. You know,
Taz is great. Taz and Shelly worked so hard behind the scenes. I gotta definitely tip my hat, you know, to them.
Well, you guys, I think you guys have a great thing going on, and you must keep it going.
Yes. Thank you. We appreciate it.
Yeah, no, it's well done. It's tremendous. And I'm so glad that you invited me on board to be a part of your very special program.
It's been a pleasure. Right. Ken, Shelly, any closing words, any announcements before we get on out of here? We're at 2 hours and 19 minutes.
Everybody stay safe. And vote.
Look out
for. Let me go ahead, Ken.
We're going to be doing some virtual concerts ourselves, Chairman of the Board, and we're also doing an I Vote concert November the 3rd. So look out for that as well. Get out and vote.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
This election coming up is absolutely critical.
Super.
And you can go online to vote.org or voter.org. It's either one of those. And find out if you're registered. and check your status in your particular state, you know. Mm-hmm. But you must get out and vote in this election coming up. Man, November is going to be critical. Absolutely yes, critical.
All yes, right. Indeed. All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen at home, we thank you for tuning in and supporting us week after week. And we made it to episode 17. Join us next week where, like Shelly said, our guest will be comedian, actor, Mr. Tommy Davidson. We looking forward to that one just as much as tonight. It's been great, guys. Y'all continue to stay safe. Continue to, you know, follow the rules of the CDC. Wash your hands, you know.
Wear your mask.
Wear your mask. Yeah. You know, don't be going a whole lot of places. Just the essentials, you know. But all jokes aside, I was being funny. But, you know, just want to limit your moving around. You know, school's about to start up too, guys. So, you know, we're praying for all the kids, all the students, and all the teachers, all the administration is going through with this. I'm homeschooling my son. We actually got to virtually meet the teacher in the morning. So, but for all of those who are going back, you know, and getting on that path of going out to public schooling, we will be, you know, thinking of you, and, you know, and you guys will be in our prayers that the children and everyone else will be safe as well.
Thank you. With that being said,
we're going to sign off for the night, and we'll see you next week. Peace, love. Thank y'all.
Thank you, Ralph.
Ralph Film. We'll be right back.